conscientiousness and the creativity of some very disciplined public affairs professionals. We have Facebook live stream this tonight. Did I say that right, Sanders? Thank you. We're glad to have you here. For those of you who are not physically here with us, wherever you may be, we're grateful you've taken the opportunity with us. Tonight we have the opportunity through lunchtime and fellowship to bring in a special guest, a gentleman named Paul Colman. He's going to tell a little bit about his story later on. But I'd like to introduce first, Colonel Ty Ferry, the commanding officer of Marine Corps Station Cherry Point. Colonel Ferry, thank you for being here. Thank you for your efforts in bringing Paul to this area. Before we begin, though, I'd like to offer a word of a brief prayer blessing. Gracious God, as we're here tonight, we give thanks for who you are and what you have done. May this time tonight be a time of blessing, and may it be a time of healing. And we give thanks to God that you are the one true God, the God of hope, the God of love, the Christ of the resurrection. For it is in the name of our Lord, our Redeemer, Christ Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Hey, good evening. How are we doing tonight?
Good.
Good. Come on. You're gonna. How are we doing tonight?
Awesome.
So we were at Cherry Point last night in the Roadhouse facility with about 200 Marines, and our guest tonight, Paul, was they were rocking last night. So I think he still got that spirit upon him from last night, from being around young Marines. So I hope you give them the same type of energy. My name is Colonel Todd Ferry. I'm the commanding officer of Marine Corps Air Station Cherry Point, just up the road. Thanks for having me tonight. Thank you for the chapel for putting this on. Thank you for Tun Tavern Fellowship here for kind of helping sponsor this. Why am I here? So I'm a fan of Paul Colman. So what do you mean? So it's an interesting little story. About 2002, my wife and I were stationed in the Naval Academy. My wife and I went to a concert on the Eastern Shore of Maryland. And a pretty prominent, can you hear? Is that what we're doing? Is that too much?
Sweet spot. Right?
Sweet spot right there. Pretty prominent Christian band called Third Day. And we went, we were very excited. And the opening act was a group called the Paul Colman Trio. Never heard of them. No clue who these people are. And so they came out, and curtain goes up, and spotlight's down, and it comes out, and I think two guys walked out. So it was a trio, Paul Colman Trio, two guys walked out from the stage, and very humbly apologized for not playing that. Say, we're from Australia, this kind of stuff, and but our lead singer had to fly back to Australia to, his wife was having a baby. And so, but if you go out into the lobby, we have these awesome CDs, this facts of our live CD, and that's actually what we sound like. So, with, you know, no further delay, Third Day. And so that's how I ran into the Paul Colman duo, because the lead singer actually was in Australia. So we, my wife and my family basically burned up that CD. We enjoyed the music. And we started following them for several years. Through Paul and kind of what he did in his career and stuff like that. And so we've been a fan, and his music has spoken to our family for years. And so he wants me to get off the stage for that.
Hey, I wasn't thinking that.
Okay. Continue on.
Okay,
I'm the opening act.
You're doing great.
All right, so. So we'll wait for people to flow in. Look at this. So I'm in Germany 2 years ago, stationed over there with the Marines, and I happen to look on Facebook or something crazy, and I don't know why I'm still following you. You know, somehow, you know, I'm watching, and I'm looking to a guy, Facebook Live, some guy stays there. And there's a guy named Paul Colman, he's gonna be like 30 minutes from where I live in Germany, in a small town called Wittenbach, in a church that was built like at 1000 AD. You know, picture this grander about 1000 years older. And, so I actually use social media, so I'm savvy. I got six kids, they taught me, and I started tweeting them. Say, hey, I'm coming, I'll be there, that kind of stuff like that. So I'm absolutely convinced he just thinks I'm whacked. I'm nuts, right? Who's hitting up on Twitter, that kind of stuff. And so I ended up driving, you know, like it's like a winter, to December, driving to a small town, and into a small German village called Winterbach, and Paul's there playing. The great German friend of his on stage. And somewhere in that night, he stopped the concert and goes, "Hey, is that guy who hit me up on Twitter here tonight?" And so I'm sitting in the back. So I am the only American in about 70 people, all Germans, right? And so that's me. And he goes, and I had told him on Twitter kind of how we first pretended to meet with the Paul Colman duo. And so the conversation looks something like this. So tell me again. So we're basically talking back and forth of our congregation of Germans. And they're like ping pong. They look at him. They look at me. Who knows if they know? We spoke English and Australian.
Yeah,
and the Germans. So it was actually very common. I couldn't believe it. I'm telling this place, "Oh, I remember that night. Yeah, this." And so we developed an odd relationship in the middle of the congregation, in the middle of the concert. We went out there that night, spent a couple hours just getting to know each other. Next year, he comes back through. I'm locked on because he's doing a Christmas concert, and we brought about 10 American couples. Come on, come with me. We're gonna have fun with me. So he spent a great evening with us hanging out. So that evening, last year, I said, "I'm moving to North Carolina. I'm gonna get there. I'm gonna invite you to come out." And I'm sure he thought I was completely moving there. And sure, who's this guy moving to North Carolina? So about 3 months ago, I said, "Come on out. Let's go." And so, without further ado.
No. I'm just coming to join you. That's
okay.
So, give me some moral support.
Okay.
Truly energy. I want to read a scripture. I want to read one scripture. I'm going to get. So, from Jeremiah. Jeremiah 5 says, "Thus says the Lord, cursed is the man who trusts in man and makes flesh his strength, whose heart turns away from the Lord. He is like a shrub in the desert, and shall not see any good come. He shall dwell in the parched places of the wilderness, in an uninhabited salt land. Blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord. He is like a tree planted by water that sends out its roots by the stream, and does not fear when heat comes, for its leaves remain green, and is not anxious in the year of drought, for it does not cease to bear fruit." Tonight you'll hear fruit. Brothers and sisters, Paul Colman.
Good job, man. Good job. Thank you. Thank you, Todd. Of all the introductions I've ever had, that was one of them. And I mean that. So a few things about that story that I need to add to. One of them was, I just knew he was like military guy. You know, "You want to come out to this base?" I'm like, "Yeah, sure, man, that sounds great. I like you, you're a good guy." So I turn up yesterday, I didn't realize he was the boss. I'm like, "Well, man, did I luck out. I have a sticker that I'm taking home and framing because it describes me in a word that no one's ever used with me before. Distinguished. It says I am a distinguished guest. Telling you, I can't repeat in this house of the Lord the words that I've been used described to me before, but distinguished. I like that. And I got a police escort. Man, I tell you. But you know, one thing I did think once I realized that Todd was the boss is I thought, well, I drove 13 hours. Surely he could have sent some sort of aircraft to come get me. Like, I mean, they got planes. No one seems to be flying around over there. So I got to tell you, if I ever come back, I'm coming back in one of those babies. Of course, the pilot's going to probably try to make me vomit. That's what they do. But anyway, I'm so glad you're here. And just so you know, if you're looking at this room, which probably would hold how many? 500? 600? Do I hear 7? 700. 700 of the man in the shirt. 750. Can we just cut it there? Sold at 750. All right, so I want you to know that this is a pretty normal size crowd for me. Right here. This is normal. But normally what we do is we pack into a small room and then on Facebook we say, sold out. All right? So that's the way we roll. All of my shows come really through word of mouth. I don't have an agent anymore. I don't have a manager, a record label. I found that the life that I really wanted centered around people, not around someone getting a call and representing me. Also, I didn't sell any records either, so it sort of helped. But this is the life that I like. And I'm here at the base, and last night, Colonel Perry in the kitchen with the lead pipe. No, that's Cluedo, sorry. Colonel Mustard. No. Todd and I were just sitting up late at night talking to these young Marines, and their stories just moved me. And so I love music. I enjoy it. But people are way better. Anyway, I'm going to sing a song now in case you think this is just a prop to hide the fact that I've eaten a lot of pizza the last 2 years. So here we go. And as usual, the plan is no plan. So I just think about what I'm going to do just before I do it. Oh yeah, I got it. This song is called Someday. Someday. I really like stories, so I write stories. Jesus told stories, so stories are probably pretty good. She was on the outside, always looking in, too scared to live her story, and just waiting to begin. Every New Year's resolution just faded into dust. Silence was her shelter, loneliness her friend, and afraid to face the audience, she learned how to pretend. Hope was hanging by a fingernail, and this is what it said. I may lose my way, but I'll keep on coming back to today. I may lose my way, but my heart will find its rhythm someday. Well, he was always trying to fill his broken heart with fairy tales and lovers' kisses, trying to light that spark in a soul filled with ambition. But he never saw the flame. His mind was a war zone, and he couldn't sleep at night. And the darkness never left him, even when the sun was bright. But hope came to him with melodies, so he began to write. Right he did. I may lose my way, but I'll keep on coming back to today. I may lose my way, but my heart will find its rhythm someday. Beats, and all you see is your defeat. Oh, hold on to the promises, redemption finds a way where there is no way. Confession time. When I was so much younger, I used to think I knew more than those around me, so much more than you. And I strutted like a peacock, I shoved my feathers in your face. But now I'm getting older, and life has called my bluff. And I'm not ashamed to say, Frankie, I don't really know that much. But I guess the things I know, I really know. And maybe that's enough. Maybe. someday. Yeah, my heart will find its rhythm someday. I hope my heart someday. And the crowd cheered. All right, good. Thank you. Now let me ask this question. How many people, please put your hands up, if when I started singing thought, where did his accent go? Come on. Yeah. The answer is, I have no idea. I don't know what happens. I have no idea. It's just like, this is the way I talk, and then that's the way I sing. I think it's because if you sing in an Australian accent, it probably sounds like someone sawing a dog in half, you know. I may lose my way. No one's going to buy that. But it happens to all people from other countries. The vowels kind of flatten themselves out. All right. So one thing that Todd Ferry, Colonel Todd Ferry, Lord Ferry, asked me to, small l, asked me to do tonight, and you know, I'm trying to learn this chain of command thing, and seeing he's put me up at the hotel, I figured that he could probably cancel my reservation at any point, so I decided to do what he asked. But I liked his idea. He just said, I really like it when you go to a concert and someone tells a little story behind the song, like why you wrote the song. Against that idea is this idea that if you have to explain a song, you probably didn't write it very well. So I'm going to try and bridge the gap there somewhere. So you have to understand this. I grew up in Australia, and Australia is considered by the United Nations an atheist country. So Australians are not religious at all, and they hate authority. So church buildings is not really the place that they're excited to head to. So I sang in the pub five nights a week and got paid, and I sang in church for free on Sunday. And that's normal for a gospel musician where I come from. I came to Nashville, I realized that ain't so normal. So what I would do is I would read the scriptures, the teachings of Jesus of Nazareth, and I would put these images into songs in a way that if I had friends coming that were familiar with the scriptures, they would hear the message. But if I had gorgeous friends who were not familiar and really didn't want to hear some sermon in a song, that they would just go, oh, that's nice. So this song is a good example. I wrote this song on a roller coaster. I know that sounds, but I didn't have this. It was just started in here. But I was thinking, a roller coaster is nothing like life. In a roller coaster, you start in this one spot and you have this incredible journey. You come back and you're in exactly the same place. First thing I thought was, life is not like a roller coaster. In life, you start here, and somewhere in your journey, you're absolutely nowhere near where you started, and you're absolutely not where you thought you'd be. Correct? Okay, we're good. Stage one. Roger that. I watched 24 to try and practice for being here. It hasn't helped at all. The second thing is Jesus of Nazareth's teachings were not easy to understand straight away. He really would have been not a very celebrated evangelical speaker, I don't think. Because he didn't have 3 points, and at the end he didn't give you like one conclusion for the week. He sort of left it hanging a bit. You had to think about it. Jesus wasn't a cheap date. You had to sit there going, what the? Who's the farmer? Even his own mates that hung out with him every day were like, Jesus, who's that guy? What did he... You know, like that annoying person at the movie? I thought he was the bad guy. Why? You know what I'm talking about. You've all got that friend. So Jesus gave this teaching that was kind of hard to understand, and he said, if you want to save your life, you have to lose it. And he, you know, got some grain of wheat in a field, and one guy's like, oh, I don't get it. Do it again. Thomas, it is wheat. Just trust me. Come on. And then he gave this teaching, and so I suddenly thought, yeah, you've got to come to the end of yourself before you can begin yourself. So this song is called The End of Myself. So it's a mixture of a roller coaster and the teachings of Jesus. Makes sense, right? I've been down a roller coaster, seen a lot of highs and lows there, and felt a thrill just to be hanging on. But life came and met me. Oh no, that's not the wrong lyric. But life's no roller coaster, though there are highs and lows there. You never end up where you started from. I build a model army. I thought they'd be fighting for me, and I'd be home for dinner and without a wound. Well, life came and met me. My soldiers joined the enemy. I ended up a million miles from home. And when I started out, sky full of eagles flying, leading me south, I never had a doubt. How could I know that this road leads to the end of myself? The seed that started out in the soil began to sprout. It grew up like a tender shoot beneath the sun. But without a stake to guide you, crooked is the path you follow. You can't even recognize what you become. And when I started out, sky full of eagles flying, leading me south, I never had a doubt. How could I know that this road leads to the end of myself? And the river is dark and it's wide, and if you make it to the other side, listen to your heart, listen to your soul. Make a brand new start. Surrender your control. Listen to your heart. Listen to your soul. Make a brand new start. Surrender your control. And when I started out, sky full of eagles flying, leading me south, how could I know that this road leads to the end of myself? End of myself, yeah. And the end of myself, yeah, yeah. Do, 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 do. Do, 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 do. Yeah, yeah. Thank you. And welcome, if you just arrived. I know. And just so you know, everyone's, before you got here, everyone stood up, said their name, and not really. All right, I'm lying. But my name's Paul. Hi, how are you? Who's the guy next to you? Nathan? David. How you going, David? Nice. How long have you guys been married? When was your 26th wedding anniversary? Pardon? You can collectively decide on the answer. What's that? Okay. David, would you come up here, please? Okay, you don't have to do anything beside receive this. This is a gift from me. This is called a CD for you young people. This is what we used to sell before Spotify came and ruined us all. But this is my gift to you. You probably have a CD player. Congratulations. And I want you to know that if you don't like the music, just keep that to yourself. I'm kind of sensitive about it. All right, but you guys can play that on your next date.
All right, well, we'll work on it. Thanks.
Nice to meet you. Please give it up for David. 26 years. Come on. That's pretty good. He walked to the back of the room. 26 long years. Yeah, he's grooving it. I see that. There's a bit of groove left in the old guy yet. Yeah. All right. I digress. So here's the story behind this next song. If you're a guitar player or a musician, this next song breaks the rules in terms of how many chords are in a song. Usually in a pop song, there's like four, maybe five. This has 11. And these pieces of music really shouldn't go together. But I wrote it with a guy who's way smarter than me, and he melded it together. I have a friend, and he was building a ridiculously big house. I had built a ridiculously big house. I had sold my house, and he'd sold his, both realizing these were ridiculously big houses. And we both agreed that we would either be building one or selling one, but we had to get it out of our system. But it wasn't until therapy that I started to understand why I built this house. And seeing we were in a church building, and the Bible says, confess your sins to one another, I'll confess. I built this house because I wanted to show everyone how well I was doing. I didn't realize that at the time. And so I was saying one thing with my mouth, but my heart was another one. So people would call up and they'd say, oh man, can I come and see the new house? And I'd say, I mean, sure, if you want to. Inside I'm like, yes. But I didn't know the word validation then. And they'd come over and they'd say, man, this place is amazing. And I'd go, yeah, it's just a house, you know, we like it. But inside I'm like, oh, yes. But like everything in life, you set out for something and you think, when I get that, when I can do that, when I have that, when I'm with that, them, that was weird. We're not talking about Utah here. I'm just saying that, them, then I'm really going to experience life. But the fact is you get there and you go, is that it? Right? So I thought, why not call this song, Is That It? So here it is. This is not on your CD, David. But if you're a good boy this whole show, I'll give you the CD that it's on. And I want you to know, I'm tracking. You're never going to come late to one of my shows again, are you? Poor guy. All he did was just turn up. All right, so this is called Is That It? They never told you when you were young that you would have your day in the sun, then it would all start coming undone. Yeah. Don't you know that it took me years, a lot of hard work, blood, sweat, and tears, just to make it with my own two hands. Yeah. Is that it? Is this what I've been living for? Gotta be something more. Hey man, take a look at my place. I love the smile that it puts on your face, but I wonder, was it worth the chase? Huh? 'Cause now I'm sitting here all alone. I guess I reap what I had sown. I'm a king on a lonely throne. Yeah. I've been living for, 'cause if that's all there is, there's something more. Whoa, is that it? Is this what I've been living for? 'Cause if that's all there is, there's gotta be something more. To my senses, finally, baby. Sometimes you get what you want, but it's not what you want. You're all that I want. So I keep asking myself, is that it? Is this what I've been living for? Are you having fun? That's good, because I can't do anything else. So, plan B is try play N again. I told you, ladies, you might not think it's good or bad, but you will find it entertaining. That's a guarantee. That's a money-back guarantee. Or is this free? I don't know. That's a free-back guarantee. Well, when I was a kid, back in the 60s and 70s, I'm 50 this year. Closer to 100 than the day I was born. I'm not afraid of it. Although, anyway. That AC's loud, isn't it? You don't realize until you hear the serenity. Listen to that. Listen to the serenity. You feel the serenity? I have no idea what I'm saying. I've never said that before. I've never asked an audience to think of the serenity. It's a good word, though, serenity. What's that? One more time. That is probably the most intelligent heckling I've ever heard in my life. Is this your first time as a heckler? I get the feeling that's true. Serenity now. It's very different than what they yell out in Australian pubs, I can tell you that for sure. Yes, so when I was a teenager, I don't think people talked about mental illness in the same way as it's okay to talk about now. It feels like every generation, like every 10 years, we think some things have gotten worse, some things get better. Me and my dad would always argue, oh, the good old days when we did this. And I'm like, yeah, that's right, racism, so tolerated, awesome. Slavery, the good old days, Dad, yeah. And then he would talk about what it's like now, and I think it's an argument that every generation has had. You know, is it getting better? Is it getting worse? Is it just that we've got cameras everywhere now? Like, I don't know. I'm not going to argue that. But I will say this. I think 25 years ago, if you talked about depression, people would kind of run away from you. Whereas now, I'm glad to say that I feel like the conversations about these things are more open. Because depression's one thing, but if you add that layer of shame, that's bad. So I will say this, I didn't realize till therapy that I'd been battling depression my whole life. I had no idea. People would just say, try harder. I'm like, you have no idea how hard I'm trying. And on that album you have, David, there's a song you young people can hear on Spotify for free, but it's a song called Dirty Little Friend. Dirty Little Friend. And I wrote it about the voice of depression and what it says to you. Well, about one of the worst times I went through was about 5 years ago when I was totally down. And there was two predominant voices in my head. Now, when I say that, I mean there's a lot of voices. I'm a nice bunch of people. But what I mean is, come on, what are you laughing at? So are you. All of you. There was two predominant voices. And one of the voices would say to me, your best days are behind you. That was it. You know, live out life, do your best, but your best days are behind. And then there was another voice that would always say, no, 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 the best is yet to come. And I knew it was God's voice because he had an American accent. What? He was Southern. Boy, let me tell you. No, not really, I joke. So that voice always said, the best is yet to come. And at that moment, I had to cling on to that hope because I didn't feel a lot of hope. And sometimes it takes a lot of faith and hope to believe in what God said because your feelings are like the opposite. And I guess that's called faith. Right, Frank? That amen gave me some encouragement just there, man. And if I don't say the right thing, you can say rubbish, you know. I feel like you will. Okay. So then I thought to myself, how am I going to express this song of hope? I got to find music that's exhilarating. So I live in Nashville, so I thought, yeah, the best is yet to come. I thought, no one's going to believe that. I mean, like, I'm not a country guy. And I tried reggae, and I'm like, come on, you're me trying to kid. I'm not from Barbados. And I tried rock, and I thought, no, I'm too lame for that. So in the end, I remembered back to this time when I was in Dublin, in Ireland. Now, just understand this for America for a second. It is not abnormal in other countries for Christians to have a drink of alcohol. Don't shoot me, I'm just telling you a truth. Around the world, that's not a weird thing. I know mostly in America it is. I didn't say you should, I didn't say you shouldn't, I just said, when you go to Germany and you're with the pastor after the show, he takes you out for a Sprite, you know. Not saying it's right, not saying it's wrong, don't send any letters to the colonel. Unless it's a check, you know. So I thought, you know what? The best way to write this is an Irish drinking song. I will qualify that to say this. I don't mean an Irish get trashed drinking song. I mean sitting around with your family just celebrating life. So this is called The Best Is Yet To Come. And if you just walked in the door, you are so welcome. I want you to know this was actually a great time because I've kind of done the crap songs just to warm up. So now it's actually the good stuff. So whoever chose this time is the genius. Who was that? Yeah, there you go. Genius. What's your name? Chap. All right. I heard the chap bit. He's the chap. Man, there's a few chaps around here. There's one, two, three. This place must need a lot of help. Yeah. Although I'm not sure why they chose you. Just kidding, just kidding. You're awesome. All right, so this is called The Best Is Yet To Come. Hey! Oh, come hear a story. Oh, come gather friends. I'll tell you a tale. Though it isn't done yet, you saints and you sinners, you daughters and sons, the best is yet to come. Hey! Here once was a valley that led to a storm, both were a darkness as real as a war, leaving us broken with nowhere to run. But the best is yet to come. Sing that with me. Yeah, the best is yet to come. Yeah! Yeah, so lift up your glasses, raise them on high. Here's to the failure we're leaving behind. Cheers to the future, cause it's just begun. Oh, the best, yeah, the best, yeah, the best. The best is yet to come. Hey! Yeah, we'll drown out the voices inside of our heads, and we'll bury the critics as though they were dead, and we'll prove to the cynics who said it can't be done that the best is yet to come. Sing it with me. Yeah, the best is yet to come. Yeah, so lift up your glasses, raise them on high. Here's to the failure we're leaving behind. Cheers to the future, cause it's just begun. Oh, the best, yeah, the best, yeah, the best. The best is yet to come. Hey! Whoa! Whoa! Isn't done yet. Let's toast to the battles we haven't yet won. Because the best is yet to come. Yeah, lift up your glasses, raise them on high. Here's to the failure we're leaving behind. Cheers to the future, cause it's just begun. Oh, the best, yeah, the best, yeah, the best. Yet to come. Hey! Yeah, the best is yet to come. Yeah, the best is yet to come. Yeah, the best is yet to come. Hey! Hey! You know, the other thing I was thinking about when I wrote that song, was John Wesley's one of my heroes, and seeing this isn't a Protestant chapel, I think it's okay to mention JW. John Wesley, like in the 15th, 16th century, 18th, 17th, around there somewhere, he would preach in the local pubs. Oh my gosh, really? And I can imagine the motley crowd there. There's probably some people there just having a drink going, "Shut, mate. Trying to show my point here. Shut up." And I remember other people going, "You shut up. He's all right." And I imagine people that were annoyed, people were glad he was there. Some people probably went there to listen to him and are upset that other people were drinking. Other people just went there to have a drink. And there's this guy, and I like that because John Wesley went to where the people are. What we are, we build a building, come to us. And he's like, no, I'm just going to go where they are already. It's cheaper. Plus, if you want people to relax, go to a restaurant, a bar, or your home. Everything in these places is designed to not so much be relaxing, except for tonight and every other night in this place and everywhere you go. Thinking, by the way, someone shared a truth with me. I'm sure I heard it before, but I never listened. What? Exactly. You're welcome. Yeah, they said, think before you speak. That's what I'm trying right now. It's a new thing for me. It really works, though. It's kind of helpful. Okay, got it. See? Works. So, it was a weird thing for a while because I'm singing in the pub one night and the church building the next, but I'm trying to sort of do the same material. It's a challenging job. And sometimes you'd mess up and you'd say, yeah, I wasn't trying to most of the time. But I've been thinking a lot recently about, really from Constantine to Elvis. So for those historians, like 330 AD to 1956, pretty much the Western Church, the Protestant, the Catholic Church, was sort of the parent of society. A lot of the laws, a lot of the governments were based on that. But I don't know if you've noticed, but every sort of year or 10 years, people care less and less about what the church has to say. Have you noticed that? Okay, it's not just me. Okay. So I'm one of those why. I was one of those kids that always asked why. I was the kid that drove you nuts. Why? 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 But why? I was always looking for the why, and I've been thinking about it a lot. So this song was part of my journey. I wrote this like 25 years ago. Happy birthday. This song is not meant to be critical of anyone. It's meant to raise a question. So it's not a judgmental song. Well, not tonight. It's called Mr. Religion. Dear Mr. Religion, seems times are not so good. You say people ain't doing the things that they know they should. Well, Mr. Religion, people say you've had your go. They're not believers, at least not in the God you show. Mr. Religion, you sing Amazing Grace. So please will you tell me, what's that patronizing look upon your face? Do you love the sinner, though you may not love the sin? And are you part of the problem and the mess we're in? 'Cause don't you people are the same wherever you go, and can't you see they're a lot like you and a lot like me? And it's only love that changes hearts and changes minds. So please, Mr. Religion, don't let them leave you behind. Hey, Mr. Religion, could you raise the limbo bar? 'Cause I can't get under it, oh no, no, not the way things are. Hey, Mr. Religion, maybe you're too quick to judge my sins, 'cause you still haven't asked me how I made this mess I'm in. And don't you know, people are the same wherever you go, and can't you see they're a lot like you and a lot like me? And it's only love that changes hearts and changes minds. So please, Mr. Religion, don't let them leave you. Don't let them leave you. Yeah. Yeah.
are the same wherever you go. And can't you see, they're a lot like you and a lot like me. And it's only love, only God's love, that changes hearts and changes minds. Changes hearts and changes minds. Changes hearts and changes minds. So please, Mr. Religion, don't let them leave you behind.
Thank you. You don't know why I'm laughing, but I'll tell you, it's because, like, I never play the song the same way. So I just do little things that I've never done before. I'm like, well, that was cool. And I have this conversation with my head, in my head. I'm singing the song, but I've sung it so many times that I'm in autopilot. So then there's other conversations where I'm like, and then I'm trying to mix the vibrato of my voice, leave you behind. And then I heard myself sounding like Aaron Neville, hanging me, you know. And all this is going on in Disneyland up here. It's raining in Disneyland, but it's good. We're having a good time. This is good. Can you believe this is my job? I mean, seriously, I was a school teacher. That's a real job. You were a school teacher? How many years were you a school teacher? 39? You started when you were 4? Come on. What did you teach? Oh. You're the top of the pile. That's awesome. Special needs. That's awesome. Wow. I was going to say something cool about myself, but that kind of trumps it now. I've been told I'm on the spectrum anyway, so I guess maybe I can talk about it. Yeah, like, being a teacher is like doing 5 shows a day to an audience that hates you. You know, whereas I'm doing like 5 a week to an audience that kind of tolerates me and generally likes me by the end. You know, I think this is easier. And you know, being a musician, there's such a great cushion. Like, if I make a mistake, like, I talked to a guy the other day that said, I saw you up in Fresno in 2019 and whatever. And he said, oh man, it was a great gig. You broke a string and then kept going. And I'm like, do you remember any of the songs? No. So what I realized about this job is if you make a mistake and recover well, people like you more. Pilots and surgeons don't get that. Ah, Mrs. Jones, I'm afraid we've cut off the wrong leg. Oh, that's all right, Doc. I got one more. Woohoo. See, this is an easy job. I mean, it's not like life-changing, but it's what's amazing is that suddenly from playing a few chords, some guys at my gig in Germany tweeting me like a real... Did you hear that? That sound really appealed to my raging ADHD. It was like I was talking and suddenly I heard, oh, what is it? But this is what's crazy about it, right? I write a few songs, I'm kind of down, and I'm trying to get out of a haze, and I'm traveling around, and then suddenly I end up in Germany, and some guy from America's there sending me a tweet. Creeper. Just kidding. And then he emails me, and then I end up in Cherry Point, now I'm here, and then he turns out to be the boss of the place. You can't make that stuff up. That's crazy. That's crazy, right? That's crazy. So that's what this life's like, and it's very dysfunctional. I heard someone say some advice the other day to a young musician. And this concert pianist, who was like absolutely the elite, said to this young musician, the young musician said, I want to do music for a living. And he's like, all right. If you can be happy doing anything else, do that. But if you can't be happy doing anything else, do music, but good luck. I was going to say I resent that comment, then I realized I resemble that comment. Sometimes I have to look at the CDs I've done just to see what songs I've written so I know what to... Okay. Yeah. Actually, there's another one here. Paul Colman Most Requested. The funny thing is I came up with that. It doesn't say most requested by whom. Oh, see, I'd forgotten that one. What do you think of it? It's catchy, isn't it? Do you know why Jesus was not born in Australia? Because they couldn't find three wise men. I was in a prayer house in Norway a few weeks ago. They have these cool things in Norway. They're called berhus. Berhus. It's a prayer house, and a whole bunch of different church groups use this one prayer house. And I was there, and I kept staring at this picture on the wall. It was a picture of Jesus. And I just couldn't take my eyes off it because it was just so weird. Like, he had blonde hair, he had blue eyes, perfect white skin, like a full, beautiful, trimmed hipster beard. And I just kept thinking to myself, man, this is a miracle. The first white guy ever born to Jewish Palestinian parents, you know? Okay. Thankful to the language barrier, I think my comment went over their heads. Otherwise, the Vikings may have come out of their ships and I'd still be there. So this song is called If I Was Jesus. If I was Jesus, I'd have some real long hair, a robe and some sandals. Exactly what I'd wear. I'd be the guy at the party turning water to wine. Yeah, me and my disciples, we'd have a real good time. And I'd lay my life down for you. If I was Jesus, I'd have some friends that were poor. I'd run around with the wrong crowd,
like you.
Man, I'd never be bored. Yeah, I'd heal me a blind man, get myself crucified. My politicians and preachers, who got something to hide? If I was Jesus, 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 if I was Jesus, I'd come back from the dead, and I'd walk on some water, just to mess with your head. I'd know your dark little secrets, I'd look you right in the face, Chaplain, and I'd tell you I love you with amazing grace. It takes a lot of grace, doesn't it? Yeah. Oh! And I'd lay my life down for you. Whoa! And I'd show you who's the boss. Whoa! I'd forgive you and adore you while I was hanging on your cross. I have a very elastic sense of time. And you probably don't. So, Colonel Ferry, how long have I been up here?
1922 or something.
Don't give me a military, give me a normal civilian timing. About an hour and 6 minutes. That is some accurate. I respect that. I respect the accuracy of that estimation. About, could give or take 40 seconds. I gotta tell you, I never really known a colonel before, you know. I mean, in previous, the only time I've ever mentioned colonel is like when I was going to KFC. But now it's like, you know, yeah, me and the Colonel, man. I think I need to write a song, me and the Colonel. This is my brand new song called Me and the Colonel. I was down in Germany, playing in a church at the foot of a castle. Okay, you know what? I know this is going to be bad. I'm just going to write it when I get home. I just got a feeling. Pull out now, Paul. I was screaming in my head. And it was the good voice. Because I heard the other one and it said, keep going. All right. Well, let's finish with a couple of songs, eh? My dad always said, leave an audience wanting more. And some of you even right now don't want any more. So I don't want to... I don't want to push it. You think this is a trick? Really, I'm really wanting to know what I wrote. Oh! Of course. This next song I wrote in Texas. Anyone from Texas? All right. Yeah. Tex, for those of you who don't know, Texas is a country. It's, right? I mean, like Australia, it's a country. Well, unless you can explain to me if your state can have the flag the same height as the American flag. Colonel Tom. Boom. Boom. I'm a Marine. Boom. First in. Boom. Last out. What am I talking about? I have no idea. Freeform rap speaking on the Marines. So I was in Texas, and I was in this little town called Utopia, Texas. Now, for some people, that's an oxymoron, but not for Texans. not for Texans. This little town of Utopia is about an hour and a half out of San Antonio. And I was with a rancher. He was a tough guy. I was terrified. We were shooting guns. It was hurting my arm. I wasn't going to say anything. So when he said, let's take a walk, I thought, beauty. Yeah, we'll do more of that gun stuff later. I didn't grow up with guns, so I was, that's a real goon. So we went for a walk, and this guy was an interesting cat because he was a psychologist, a novel writer, and a Texas rancher. You know those people that have the right and left side of the brain going at once? They terrify me. I don't even know which one's the right and left in terms of that's how right or left my brain is. It's right. No, it's left. No, it's right. That's right. No, it's left. Whatever. So we were walking, and he noticed, because it was his property, 3,000 acres. He said, have a look at that collection of cactus leaves over there. Look at that one right in the middle. I'm thinking, there's like 400 of them there. What one are you talking about? I didn't say that. He had guns. And so I said, which one in particular? And when I looked, right in the middle, there was this cactus leaf shaped perfectly like a love heart. And I had one of those booking moments, like when the air conditioning comes on. It was like a... Wouldn't it be great if every time you had a great idea, there was just that sound? He goes, Colman, it's going to be good. Some people actually have that sound. And I suddenly got triggered for a song, because when I looked at that cactus-shaped heart, I thought, that's my heart. It's prickly. I've even been called, no. Thanks for laughing at that, you made me feel better. You bad girl. What am I going to tell the church people after that? She laughed at a dirty joke. Back on point. I looked at this cactus heart, and I really had this image of my own heart, because I'm prickly. You know, I got beaten up and smashed around when I was a kid because I've always had this personality. And when you're 9, yeah, and you won't shut up, and you're always needing to be the center of attention because you have this powerful gift, but you have no idea how to manage it. You feel like a stallion running around with a bunch of Shetland ponies. And you don't want to be a stallion. You're trying to make your legs shorter, but they don't get shorter. And so I didn't know where the off switch was. Matter of fact, I didn't know where the on switch was or pause. And so I just got beaten up. And so emotionally, I kind of grew up in this position. I was like, someone reached out to hug me. I was just trying to hug you. I didn't know. I thought you were going to hit me. I was like the junkyard dog, you know? So when I looked at this heart, I thought, man, that's my heart. I'm prickly. Who wants to hug a guy with a cactus heart? That's painful. So I came home. This is the only song I've written in under 10 minutes that doesn't completely suck. Trust me, I've written some in under 10 minutes and I would never play it to you. Matter of fact, people think I'm a good songwriter. It's not true. I just release the good ones. Trust me, I could release 20 albums of the bad ones. And you'd be really encouraged if you're a songwriter. So this song is called Your Cactus Heart. Your Cactus Heart. And the lyric was inspired by an old song I'd written that everything was awful in the song except this one line. And this line triggered this lyric. And this line said, there is a sign outside your house that says, keep out, please don't disturb. But you stand with a smaller sign in the window that says, if you can, please ignore the first. So I can dedicate this to anyone who's a little prickly. You want people to love you, but it's so hard to receive it. A little Texas in there for you. Thank you.
I love your cactus heart, your 10-foot wall, your armored car. And I love your loaded gun, ready to fire on anyone who doesn't say just what you want, who dares to speak with their own tongue. And I love your smile and laugh that hides your anger from getting past. And how do I love these awful things I hear you say? 'Cause I can see why, and I can see you, and I can see why you do the things you do, and I can see when, right at the start, they hurt you, child, and they taught you how to grow a cactus heart. I love your ready shoes that run you away when you think you lose. And I love your thorny words laced in sugar but with bitter herbs. And I love your standards high that you can't reach even though you try. And I love your salty tears when you realized the ones you've pierced. And how do I love these awful things I hear you say? 'Cause I can see why, and I can see you, and I can see why you do the things you do, and I can see when, right at the start, they hurt you, child, and they taught you how to grow a cactus heart. They build a mountain you can't climb. I know that you know that there's blood on my chest when I hold you close. And I know that you've tried. You're tired of the loneliness of letting no one close. But I still love you, child. I still love you. 'Cause I can see why.
We got insurance? Okay. You know, when I first sang that song, I was at a church group in San Antonio, and I didn't make it through the song. I didn't make it. I got to the point where it said, one word at a time, build a mountain you can't climb. And I know that you know that there's blood on my chest when I hold you close. And I just broke down crying. Not cool. Not in Texas. Not even when the Cowboys lose. And the pastor, after a while, I wasn't trying to cry. I wasn't being dramatic. It wasn't like some sort of acting technique. And the pastor said, what happened? And I said, I think I just got my own song. I think I just realized what I was singing. Anyway, so let me leave you with this last song and this last introduction to this song. The irony about this next song is it's probably one of my most popular songs in different parts of the world. If you've never heard of me, don't worry, most of you I never heard of either. So it's all good. It doesn't matter. I'm kind of over myself. 7 years of therapy will help with that. It was expensive though. But the irony about this next song is when I actually wrote it, the song said, I don't really understand, do you love me? And it was really me thinking about God, do you really love me? Like, really? Like, I've just started to really find out who I am, and it's not pretty. It's not a Cinderella story. It's a broken story. I started getting names to things like toxic shame, codependence, fear, anxiety, chronic anxiety, depression. I had it all. And I'm like, you know, so this song is like, do you really love me? Like, I've traveled around, I've questioned everything, but the real question I have is, do you love me? The guy I was writing it with said, I think that song will be more popular and better if you actually said, I've questioned everything, but the one thing I don't question is that you love me. I said, yeah, but is that honest? And he said, let me ask you a question. Do you believe God loves you? And I went, in theory, but I don't really feel it. I still look in the mirror and I see what I see, which is just a loser. Someone that gets up every night and fakes it and people think he's a cool guy, but underneath it, I'm angry and I hate people half the time. I sing about Jesus all weekend and I fly him on a plane, and if someone kicks my seat, I just want to smack him. And he said, well, do you want to know in your heart that God loves you and the way he sees you? And I'm like, yeah. And he goes, well, here's my thought. Two things will happen if you do this my way. Number one, it'll be a better song and you'll pay your bills for once. I'm like, you got my attention. He said, but more importantly, you speak this song out, you sing this song out. There is power in speaking out the truth. And God does love you. You are his kid. And when he looks at you, he doesn't see you as you should be, because you'll never be as you should be. He loves you right there, right in that moment, whether you are flipping him off or praising his name. Whether you are right in the middle of sin or right in the middle of confession. No matter who you are, he intensely loves you. So I went with it. And so please, as you hear this song, understand that I've been chasing this song around the world for 15 years. And every time I sing it, I just get a little closer to believing in faith that the way God sees me is not the way I see me. That he looks at me and he goes, that's my kid right there. Yeah, he's got some problems. We're working on that, buddy. I like that kid. I freaking like that kid. Even when his breath smells like death. Even when his hair is like a madman's breakfast, even though he's been eating pizza and stacked on a few pounds, I still just love him. I love that kid. That's the way he feels about all of us. But you know, the funny thing is, even in the walls of the faith community, I don't know how many of us truly in our souls believe that. And sometimes I think we're asking people to have a revolution that we've never had ourselves. Well, anyway, if I'm any example, that would be true. Grammy-nominated, Dove Award-winning person who doesn't really understand God's love. Paul Colman. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. So this song is called The One Thing. I'd like to finish with it. If you're someone that still believes in purchasing a CD and putting it in your car or at home, I have a box right there. Can you see my merchandise display? I carry that flag everywhere with me. Not really. But if you'd like to buy a CD, they're $10. Tonight I'm doing an Australian special, 2 for $20. I mean that. So thanks for listening. Thanks for having me. Tomorrow night I'm playing on the beach somewhere. Emerald Isle. If you know what that is, I don't. But I'm playing on the Emerald Isle. Sounds pretty fancy, doesn't it? I'm going to have a mermaid costume and everything. So I'm playing there tomorrow night. And then Friday night I'm singing at Cherry Point. Hosted by the boss, not Springsteen, that boss. So if you don't feel like you've had enough, which shocked me. What are you laughing at? Out. You and your family. All right, this is called The One Thing. Thank you so much for having me. Thank you to the folks on Facebook Live. I've tried not to think about you because I'll be nervous. You sit there in your home and make comments that are really brave. Really brave. Yeah, well, here I... Goodbye, darling. I was just saying goodbye. Hey, wait, can you take a CD just for free because I feel like it? Just right there. Just take one. Your money's no good with me. Come on, take one. Yeah, take two. There's two different kinds. But that's kind of reverse upselling. And there's one with a black cover. Take that one too. Yeah, one of each. Yeah, I'll even give you some music while you're choosing. That's it. You got the collection. No, that's enough. That's enough. See ya. See ya. I mean, personally, I would have waited for the last song, but that's okay. All right. All right. Yeah, well, here I am in a river of questions. Can I pour my heart out to a listening ear? Well, I see this life, its valleys and mountains, and I think of all the roads that brought me here. Oh, that brought me here. I don't know the names of the roads. 70, 45, 61, 27, 19. I question my reasons, this life I'm living. I question my ability to judge wrong from right. And I questioned all the things I've ever called certain. My race, my religion, my country, my mind. But the one thing I don't question is you. You really love me like you say you do. You really love me like you say you do. So hold me. Come on now, hold me. Well, I've questioned existence, meaning and relevance. Does the work I'm doing really matter at all? And I've questioned my friendships, alliance, dependence. Well, who will still be here when I fall? But the one thing I don't question is you. You really love me like you say you do. Yeah, the one thing I don't question is you. You really love me like you say you do. So hold me. Hold me tighter than your iPhone. Hold me. Hold me. I'm lost without you. Hey, let's take it to the bridge. Come on, same chords. Yeah. Only one thing doesn't change. Only one thing stays the same. All I know at the end of the day is your love remains. Yeah. Only one thing doesn't change. Only one thing stays the same. It's not on the record like that. All I know at the end of the day is your love remains. Hallelujah, hallelujah, oh, your love remains. Long after everything is gone, your love remains. Hey. And the one thing I don't question is you. You really love me like you say you do. You're the one thing I don't question is you. It's our hero. You really love me. You really love me like you say you do. Thank you. Good night. Facebook Live!